stand as we worship and praise the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We praise you, God. Let our praise be your welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you. We are here for you. Yes, we are. Let your breath from heaven.
Glad you're here. Glad to see your faces. You know, we come to this week every year. We're starting Holy Week. We're starting the week where we're going to be reflecting and remembering on the love that God showed us through the sacrifice of his son, Jesus. And as we come to this week specifically, this Sunday, this is the Sunday where when we look back at Scripture, then it's what they call Palm Sunday, where when Jesus was entering Jerusalem, then the crowds were waving palm branches, and they were shouting that word, Hosanna. It was that scripture that Stephanie was just reading from Matthew chapter 26, where they were shouting Hosanna and they were welcoming Jesus in And by them shouting that, you know, in the Old Testament, that word would say, God, would you come and save us? And by them saying that, they were acknowledging that they were thinking that Jesus was going to be the political leader that would come and save them. But they had no idea that Jesus was actually coming to bring such spiritual victory and spiritual freedom. And so when we sing that today, then we're saying, Lord, thank you for your salvation. I welcome in your salvation. And, you know, as a church over the years, we've had different songs where we've sung that word, Hosanna. We've had that one years ago, the Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. And then years later, there was a song that came out that was the Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And year after year, we say that same word. It's the same biblical truth, but we find new ways to say it. And then we come to this year, we've had this song where we've taught it over the last few weeks. And it's welcoming the Lord, it's acknowledging who He is. It's saying, Lord, I know that you're the one that brings salvation. Come on, let's continue that. Let's sing this together. We sing.
This is the word. Here in the flesh, living among the meek and lowly, the voice of God is every breath, salvation of the world unforced.
Behold,
behold him, behold. Yeah.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is no Why should we fear? Why should we worry about tomorrow? He is Lord. He is Lord over all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we're so grateful. We sing these songs today with grateful hearts because of who you are and what you've done for us. As we remember this week, as we reflect this week on the life and on the death and the resurrection of our Savior Jesus, we're just so grateful that through his life, God, we have life and we have hope. So we thank you, God. And we ask, Lord, that your spirit would move in power in this place as we open your word together. Would you speak to our hearts, Lord? We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Amen. Harvest, you can take a seat as we continue.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Tommy Kreitz. I serve as the lead pastor of our student ministry, and I'm also on our teaching team. And I'm so glad that you joined us today. Hey, we would love to know where you're watching from today, so let us know in the chat or in the comments. And if this is your first time with us, I'm so glad that you chose Harvest today. And no matter where you're watching from, we are grateful that you came. And whether you're new or you come every single week, we want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page on the Harvest website, or you can do it through a link in the comments on YouTube or Facebook, or you can do it through the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love to know that you are here. And I know that we say this pretty regularly, but we also want to know how we can pray for you this week as well. As a staff, we count it a great honor to come alongside you and pray with you about the joys and the burdens on your heart. So thank you so much for doing that. And if you're not a guest, we want to help you worship the Lord through giving. And here are some ways that you can give. You can give online on this page. You could also hold up your camera on your phone up to the QR code on this screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on the Harvest website. You can give through Harvest Bible Chapel app. You could do it through text or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. Well, the elders of Harvest, our church, are calling the church to prayer this week in three specific areas. The first is to prepare our hearts to remember the sacrifice of Jesus for us on Good Friday, and then rejoicing in the resurrection on Easter Sunday. The next is for perception, wisdom, discernment, clarity, and unity for our elders through what we trust will be the final steps in the search for the new lead teaching pastor. And then finally, for the Lord to provide financially for his church here in Chicagoland. We need the Lord to show up in a way that is unmistakably him. And we're asking the Lord to provide the funds needed to continue to be a church marked by unapologetic preaching, unashamed adoration, unceasing prayer, unafraid witness, and unconditional love. All right, so check out these dates and times this week, and know that most of our campuses have an online option as well. So Tuesday, March 30th at 7 p.m., the prayer meeting is going to be at the Rolling Meadows campus and Chicago Cathedral as well. On Wednesday, March 31st at 6:30 p.m., it's going to be at the Aurora campus. Also Wednesday, March 31st at 7 p.m., it's going to be at the Elgin campus. Then on Thursday, April 1st, it's going to be at 6:30 p.m. on the North Shore campus. And then again on Thursday, April 1st, it'll be at 7 p.m. at our Crystal Lake campus. And listen, if you didn't get any of that, listen, you can get all of the details at harvestnow.info. Thanks for checking that out and praying with us as a church. So excited to do that together, family. And so listen, mark your calendars for Thursday, April 8th at 7:30 p.m. for our next worship night for everyone at the Rolling Meadows campus. And it's going to be available online as well. I love doing that every single month. It has been so good for my soul and for our church to worship together. It's so awesome. Come, it's going to be amazing. And listen, I want to invite you, we've got some stuff coming up. I want to invite you to attend one of our Good Friday services on Friday, April 2nd. And these services are going to take place in person on all six of our campuses, and it's also going to be available online. Our Good Friday services are at 4 p.m. at Rolling Meadows and Elgin and online, and at 6 p.m. at all of our campuses and online as well. And this is a ticket event, and seating is limited on each campus, and you can get all of the details about Good Friday and your tickets. They're free at harvestnow.info. And then we've got, of course, after Good Friday is Easter, and we're going to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ in person on all of our campuses and here online Sunday, April 4th. And there is really nothing quite like Easter at Harvest. And we want you to join us. I'm gonna be preaching and sharing the good news of the gospel, and I'm going to bring it. And I would just encourage you, we've got some digital invites, and we would love for you to invite your friends or your family or people who are close to you who need to hear the hope of Jesus. This is a great opportunity to do that. People are so likely to join you during Easter time. And so invite someone to come and hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news that has transformed all of us. So excited to preach the gospel to our church family and to guests coming into our church as well. So you can get all of the service times, locations, Harvest Kids info, and more at harvestnow.info. Well, as we go to the Lord in prayer now, I want to invite you to pray for people to come to know the Lord this week or to return to the Lord in this coming week of Easter. So let's pray together. God, we love you. We are so thankful to be here worshiping you. And Lord, we pray for this next week as we walk into Holy Week together as a church family. Lord, would you place in our lives people who we can interact with and invite to come to church to hear the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we could celebrate all together the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Lord, that they would come and maybe even hear the gospel for the first time and would come to saving faith in you in that moment. Lord, we're praying for many to come and do that. Lord, we're also praying that you would renew and strengthen the faith of those who, all of us, have gone through a pretty difficult year. And so we are ready, Lord, to celebrate and fix our eyes on you in celebrating your resurrection, Jesus Christ. And we love you, we praise you, we give this to you. We're so excited to come here and worship you right now. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Displayed for us, oh God, we thank you for the cross. Thank you. Lifted up on Calvary's hill, we curse your name, and even still, you bore our shame and paid the cost. bright as the sun, we'll bow before the King of Kings, oh God, forever we will sing. Come on and pour out your thanks to the Lord. Just lift up a shout of praise or clap your hands.
Feel free to just even lift your hands to the Lord as just a sign and an outward expression of saying, Lord, I glorify you, and I am so thankful for the fact that your resurrection, that the story of the cross means life for me. Oh God, I'm thankful for that. It brings me joy. Draws my heart to thanksgiving like nothing else. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, 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 we say together, amen. Amen, church. Amen. 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 It's so good to worship together. We're going to open up God's word. We're going to learn from it, be shaped by it. Let's go ahead and take a seat as we continue.
Morning. Who said that? Thank you. I feel welcome when you call me by name. That's great. It is wonderful to be with you. I love Palm Sunday. If I could bring each of you to Israel with me, one of my favorite things to do is when we go to Jerusalem, we go up to the Mount of Olives and we walk down Palm Sunday Road, and we are there. We feel it. We sense it. In fact, I wish I could bring you with me to Israel. Well, maybe I can. Let's watch this video.
Hey, Harvest. Welcome. We have an exciting announcement to make. I'm here. My name is Mike Van Lanningham. I'm here with my dear friend, Mike Rydelnik, and we are going to be leading a trip, a Harvest trip to Israel.
The dates for that are October 17th through 28th, 2022. It's going to be a great trip. We're going to walk where Jesus walked. In fact, we're going to run where Jesus walked. And in fact, we're also going to sail where Jesus walked when we go on a boat ride at the Sea of Galilee. We're going to have the Bible open up for us on site. The cost is going to be around $5,000. We haven't yet, it's all tentative. We haven't yet determined the final price, but we have determined the dates. We have determined that we're going to have a great time, and we're going to learn the word in a way that's really memorable, and you'll never forget it when you see the Bible come alive on site in Israel.
Harvest Christian Academy is also doing their own tour, but this is different from that. That's for students, that's for their families, this is different. Come with us to Two Michaels, to Israel. It'll be a blessing for your heart, for sure. See you then.
So, how can you go to Israel? Well, the first thing to do is plan on which bank you're gonna rob. No, let him who steals, steal no more. But you can start saving now, and we'll be just in a month or two or a week, somewhere around there. We're going to open registration. It's going to be exciting to go there. It's a year and a half from now. We're convinced that it'll be okay to travel by then, and it's just going to be a great time. Well, let me tell you about a time where Eva and I were going to have a great time. My wife and I were going to pick up our son from a program he was in. He was in high school, but he was in a summer program in New York City, and we were going to pick him up. And it was a very precise time. And then we had to drive to upstate New York, so we couldn't just fly into New York. We had to drive in from Chicago, and we had a very precise pickup time and to get to Manhattan. And so we left here in Chicago and began to drive. And, you know, it was wonderful because our other son was in camp and this son was in New York and we were alone in the car, which is fantastic. And as we were driving, we're having a good time, you know, road trip. It's fantastic. And we're just heading down I-80 and cutting down under the lake. And we knew we'd be there on time because we were just going to move it. And then all of a sudden, we looked up and we saw a sign that said, "Welcome to Michigan." And I thought, we're not supposed to go through Michigan. Well, we had been so distracted having a good time that we wandered off I-80 and somehow ended up on I-94, totally in the wrong direction, heading north instead of east. And then we had to turn around somehow and find our way back. It was a tight schedule. We were really nervous. We had lost about an hour, and we were in trouble. So, we'd taken a wrong turn. That's really what happened, and we didn't even realize it. And I thought, that's a sort of a parable of our lives. So often we're going along, it just seems like everything's okay, and we don't even remember taking that turn, but we're off in the wrong direction. We're wandering far from where we ought to be, and it will lead to disaster. And the amazing thing is, the Lord comes in, steps in, stops us, turns us around, and sets us off in the right direction. That's what God's grace is about. And that's what we're looking at when we study Ephesians 1, how God has stepped in and transformed our direction to Him. So what I want to do is just kind of remind us of what we're about when we're talking about Ephesians. We're studying the book of Ephesians about understanding the great wealth that God has, living in light of our eternal portfolio. Let's see, is that going to come up there, that chart of Ephesians? There we go. And we are really at the beginning of it, where the first half is the believer's wealth. That's sort of getting out our eternal bank book and seeing all that God has given us. And then we're going to talk about our walk and our warfare. And we're in chapter 1, which deals with the riches of redemption. Let's kind of take a look at chapter 1 in summary here. There's a little outline that we need to remember when we think about the structure of chapter 1. In chapter 1, verses 3 through 14, we're called to praise for our spiritual benefits. There's a declaration of our benefits in verse 3. It says, God has blessed us, the triune God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Every spiritual benefit. And then it gives the details. And last week we talked about the Father's plan. The Father planned our salvation. This week we're going to talk about the Son's provision and the Spirit's protection. And then next week we'll look at the prayer for spiritual perception. Or not next week, 2 weeks from now, the prayer for spiritual perception. So what we want to talk about today, we already know that the Father planned our eternal salvation. This is not a surprise. It's not like God looked down at you and me and he said, wonder what's going to become of them. I hope this person decides to know me. No. God knew. He had the plan from before the foundation of the earth. Before the first brick was laid, the Father planned our salvation. But today we want to talk about the role of the Son and the Holy Spirit. And so we should praise God for the Son's provision, not just the Father's plan, but we should praise God for the Son's provision. And if you look with me in chapter 1, and we're going to read through verse, chapter 1, verse 7 through verse 12. Here's what it says in verse 7. In him, that's the Lord Jesus, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in the Messiah as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in the Messiah might be to the praise of his glory. Well, we can see what the Son has provided. The very first thing the Son has provided the first benefit the Son has provided for us that we have to praise him for is that the Son has redeemed us from sin. You can see that in verse 7. It says that in him we have redemption through his blood. The meaning of the word redemption, it's a word you hear all the time, right? Redemption. What does it mean? It means that we were slaves. We were all on the slave block of sin. And there we were, slaves, no way out. And the Son came and paid to redeem us, to deliver us from the slave block of sin, and the purchase price was his blood. He set us free to be his slaves, to be his servants, but a servant that serves him not out of being purchased, that he owns us, but we choose. Now that he has set us free, we said we willingly will serve you. That's what we have chosen to do. But it means to be bought back from the slave block of sin. Messiah paid the ransom. The Lord Jesus paid for us. We're freed from slavery to serve the living God. Now, I think of this sometimes when I read the verse about redemption by his blood, and it makes me think of Passover. How fitting, because today is the first day of Passover. Last night was the first Seder. Tonight we're going to celebrate a Seder with a number of us together. We're going to have a Passover meal. Passover is the story of Israel, who had been slaves in Egypt, being redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. You know the story. We were slaves in Egypt, and God stretched forth his mighty arm and his strong hand and delivered us. He gave us he sent the plague upon the Egyptians about the slaying of the firstborn. He said, take a perfect, spotless lamb and take its blood and put it on the doorposts of your house. And when I pass through Egypt to bring about judgment, what did he say he would do? I will pass over you. That's how we got the name. Okay, so I will pass over you. And he passes over judgment. And every Seder, you'll see, we pick up a lamb bone, and we're reminded that the Lord Jesus, when he came to be baptized, what did he do? John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And so it reminds us of the Lord Jesus. We were redeemed with his pure, unblemished body. It was his imperishable blood that was offered for us, according to 1 Peter 1, that gave us his pure redemption. The whole picture in Exodus was designed to look forward to the greatest Passover, and that's why Paul writes, for Messiah, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us, our Passover lamb. So that's what it makes me think of with redemption. But I still, you know, at the Seder, at the meal, we are supposed to remember this, that because we don't really feel generally like we were slaves. And so we are reminded in the Haggadah, the book that we use, that we are to consider ourselves as all having been slaves and delivered from Egypt. For if the Lord had not delivered our ancestors, it says, then we, our children, our grandchildren, we all would have still been slaves in Egypt. So we should all consider ourselves slaves that have been delivered. And I thought, well, that's good, and I'm glad to remember that. But I really didn't feel like I had much connection to slavery. And then one day, as I was pondering this idea of redemption, I thought, wait a minute. Both my parents had been slaves. We don't ever think about it. Not even just slaves to sin. They were actual slaves. Both my parents were captured by the Nazis. My dad was sent to the Ludge ghetto. I have a picture of him, actually, from the Ludge ghetto. That's my dad in the middle. You can see his yellow star that he's wearing that says Yuda. The shorter woman to the right was his first wife, who died in Auschwitz. And there he is. I don't know who the other woman is, some friend of theirs. But that's my dad in the Ludge ghetto when he first became a slave. And then he went to the Gross Rosen concentration camp and was liberated on May 8th, 1945, liberated from slavery. He was a real slave. And my mom, that's her first day in concentration camp. Now, you think, boy, that doesn't look so bad. She was a nurse. She's checking people in. You can see the auxiliary police officer there overseeing the operation. But what they had done is they took pictures to make it show, to show the Red Cross about how well Jewish people were being treated in concentration camps. And then within a week, the SS took over the concentration camps, and it wasn't so good. In fact, by the time my mom was liberated, 5'7", she weighed less than 70 pounds. This is a picture of her 1 year after liberation. Her hair had just started to grow back. She had lost all her hair because of malnutrition while she was in concentration camp. She was a slave. And it is remarkable to me that I have such a close relationship, such a just one generation apart from actual slavery. And the point of this is we're supposed to praise God because we're slaves. If we know Jesus, we were redeemed from slavery to sin. And we cannot help but praise him. The principle of redemption is that we're really free from sin's obligation. We are really free and able to serve God. That's what this is about. It is remarkable to me that we sometimes forget that we have really been redeemed. We're called upon to praise him. And, you know, my mom had no illusions about the Soviet Union. She, as soon as she was liberated, she was in a DP camp. She was liberated by the Russian Red Army. She went to a DP camp. As soon as she could get out and get into the American sector, she was out of there. And I grew up during the Cold War. My mom had no illusions about the Soviet Union. But you could never say anything bad to her about the Russian army or those Russian people. Because all she could ever say is, they're the ones that delivered me, that redeemed me. She could only say good about them. They're the ones that gave me the first food. And they didn't give me too much so I wouldn't be sick. She lived always grateful for what they had done for her. And so I think that's what we ought to be doing as well. We ought to be living a life of praise because the Son has really redeemed us from sin. And secondly, the Son has forgiven our debt. It says here verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. The meaning of the word forgiven is to cancel a debt or grant. Oh, I see what they've done. I think you guys have a lot more information on this PowerPoint or whatever this thing is than I ever anticipated. Someone gave them my sermon notes, and so there you have everything. The meaning of the word forgiven is to cancel a debt or grant release from a legal charge. The idea is more of a pardon than a decision not to prosecute, or when someone else pays your debt to the bank so that nothing more is owed. If you want to know what it's like, Eve and I finished Moody Bible Institute. We had a tuition-paid education. Everyone, if you want a great Bible education and you don't have an undergraduate degree, you can get a tuition-paid education at Moody Bible Institute. How cool is that? But then we were going to go to another school out in Los Angeles, a liberal arts school, because Moody at that time was back in the days of Abraham Lincoln, was only 3 years. And so we had to go to another university for our fourth year of college. And so we went, and we saw the bill from a regular private liberal arts university, and it was really expensive. And we got a little scholarship and a really big loan, and I thought, I don't know how we'll ever pay this. I thought, well, we'll both work full-time and get bad grades. That's what we'll do and finish our degree. And the night before we were going to leave, we had been working as camp counselors in this camp in the Adirondacks. There's a guy that came up to us and said, so how are you paying for school? And I told him, well, we're both going to work full-time. We'll take this loan, and it's going to be really awful, but we'll do it. And he said, oh, let me get back to you. And in the morning, he tells us, he called up this foundation that wanted to help sponsor Messianic Jews to get a good Bible-based education, and the foundation had agreed to pay our debt. And I said, for what? And I thought maybe they meant the part that wasn't going to be paid by the loan. He said, no, everything, all that you could never pay, that you thought, how will I do this? It's paid for. I said, really? And then he said, and also, when Eva goes to graduate school next year at Wheaton, paid. And when you go to Dallas Seminary, 4 years, paid. Every bit of debt that you are ever going to incur has been paid. And they really believe you should study in Israel next summer too. And so that summer program you had hoped to go to study historical geography in Israel, paid. It was payment that I couldn't believe it. By the way, all of you who are parents of students in university, that foundation no longer exists. That's what it means that he paid, that he forgave us. The debt that we had was forgiven. The payment was made for us. We were pardoned. That's the idea of when it says that he forgave our trespasses. God, according to this passage, forgave us according, see what it says here? According to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us. God forgave us in accordance with his wealth. That's how he forgave us. He didn't forgive us out of his wealth, but in accordance, in association with his wealth. I don't know if you ever heard, John D. Rockefeller was a notorious penny pincher. If he gave you a tip of a dime, that's what he did. He gave out of his wealth. That's not how God gives. God gives according to his wealth. You may have never heard of a guy named Julius Rosenwald. Anyone ever hear of Julius Rosenwald? Anybody? Boy. Well, a long time ago, more than 100 years ago, Julius Rosenwald bought out a guy named Sears in the Sears and Roebuck Company. And he's the one that took that company to the heights so that it was the Amazon of its day. And he became enormously wealthy. And he started the Rosenwald Foundation. And what he did is he started 5,000 schools in the South, paid for them, so that African-American children who were not able to go to school because there was no school in their area could now go to school. He also did all sorts of philanthropy. He's actually most remembered, if you look him up on Wikipedia, as a philanthropist. But you probably, if you live in the Chicago area, have benefited from him because he started this thing called the Museum of Science and Industry and paid for it to begin. If $5 million. Back in the day when $1 million was a little bit of money, you know. Julius Rosenwald believed it was his responsibility not to give out of his wealth, but to give according to his wealth. He gave immensely. And that's what this is saying that God did. He immensely enriched us spiritually. He forgave us according to his wealth that he has. He pardoned us. He forgave the debts that we have. And we have to, I would say, beware of two false views that comes when we experience God's extravagant forgiveness. We accept God's forgiveness, but then we refuse to forgive ourselves. You ever find that? We say, God has forgiven me, but then we think about the sins that we have committed, and we say, my goodness, I should have known better. I just hate myself for doing that. Listen, if God can forgive us, certainly we can forgive ourselves. The second danger that we have when we accept God's extravagant forgiveness is we accept God's forgiveness and believe there'll be no consequences for the wrong things we continue to do. Yeah, there's going to be consequences for sin. We can't mess up. I really was heading up to Michigan, you know. There's going to be consequences. I almost was late. If I had gone any further, I would have been late. There's always going to be consequences. God in his mercy sometimes restrains it. But we ought to be careful and not say, hey, look, I got pardoned. I can do anything I want now. That's ridiculous. What we want to do is live for him and live in obedience to him, because there's always going to be damage done if we disobey. Those are the consequences of sin. Let's talk about the Son has redeemed us. He has pardoned us. He has forgiven us. And then thirdly, what he has done, we praise him because he has disclosed the secret of his plan for the future. It says in verse 9, he has made known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Messiah as a plan for the fullness of times to unite all things in him, things in heaven, things on earth. The meaning of the word mystery here that he has disclosed is not like a Sherlock Holmes mystery. It's not like Columbo. You know, there's one more thing I'd like to ask you. Something's bothering me. It's not that. It's a secret that has been disclosed. That's what the word mystery means. A secret that has been disclosed. It's much more like the Beatles. Listen, do you want to know? That's what it is. It's a secret that has been told. And the secret that has been told to us is that God, through his Son, is going to put all things together. It is God's plan for administering the days of fulfillment. And it refers to the Messianic kingdom when Jesus comes and reigns on the throne. When Jesus will reign on earth and everything is subject to him and everything is summed up in him and he is the object of everything. He has told us the secret plan that he is not just going to redeem us from sin, but he's going to redeem the whole earth from sin. And he's going to set up a kingdom in which the Son of God reigns over the whole world. It's all going to be connected to him. And what this does for us is we praise him because it gives us hope. You know, we live in a world that is in a mess. Have you noticed? A global pandemic. You may have noticed that. And I just look at the world. There's the civil war in Syria and Iran trying to get the nuclear weapon. And what else have we got? Oh, shootings? We have school shootings. And if that were... That's terrible, I believe. And then, of course, there's shootings in Atlanta and shootings in Colorado. People have gone crazy. We live in a world that is extremely messed up. And when we look at the future, we have hope because we know the end of the game. We know how it's going to turn out. Jesus will return, and he will reign on his throne. That gives us hope. He has disclosed the secret of what he's going to do. That's what it says, how he's going to sum up all things in Jesus. He's going to reign over us in righteousness. That's the future kingdom that he'll reign over. I think that's so cool. You know, sometimes we get discouraged. Am I allowed to say this here? I'm a huge Yankees fan. And I used to record ball games when I was out. When I lived in New York, I would record the game on the video, you know, the VCR, remember those? Okay. I would record it, and then I would watch the game at night. I would tell people, don't tell me what happened. Don't tell me what happened. Well, one day I heard the Yankees won, and someone told me, and I was like so annoyed. But I thought, well, I'll see how they won. Well, it's the ninth inning, and they are losing by 7 runs, and the best closer in baseball is pitching against them. And I said, that person pulled my leg. There's no way they're going to win this one. And then, all of a sudden, they mounted a rally. And they beat Dennis Eckersley, at the time, the best closer in baseball. And I watched this video, and I thought, you know, I lost hope. Because it looked so grave. It looked so bad. But I should have trusted. I knew the outcome. That's what this is saying, is we can have hope. Because we know how it ends. And no matter how bad it looks now, we can have hope. Because God has disclosed to us the secret of what he is going to do. We also can praise the Son, because verse 11 and 12 says that the Son has made us his inheritance. Now, when I look at this verse here, it says, in him we have obtained an inheritance. Do you see that in your Bible? It says that he had... we have obtained an inheritance. And the problem is, I think it's much more likely that it means, and some versions, not the ESV, but some versions say, not that we have obtained it, but we have become an inheritance. It's not that he gives us an inheritance. Rather, what this is saying is that he made us his inheritance. The Father has taken you and me. And because we have been redeemed, because we were devalued by sin, but because the Father sent the Son who died for us and paid for that redemption and was raised again, because of that, what this is saying is that we are God's, the Father's, inheritance that he's given the Son. I would think, man, if I look down and said, Rydelnik, I saw someone say, you know, Rydelnik's your inheritance. I think I would run away. Because I know what I'm like. By the way, I feel the same way about you. Because I know what we're all like. But this passage says that we have become the inheritance for the Son. Here's why. Because we were created by God. And so we have infinite worth. And then he paid an infinite price to redeem us. And that gives us even more worth. Never worthy, but valuable. And because of what he has done, he has made us a trophy of his grace so that we will be his inheritance forever. And the Lord Jesus will say, what a fantastic inheritance. Isn't that something? It is amazing that we could be considered so valuable. I hope that will change our perception. Our self-esteem doesn't come from being so tall, have such great hair. It doesn't come from being able to write or speak. That's something. It doesn't come from any kind of things that we think of ourselves as being. It comes from the fact that God made us and then paid an infinite price through the Son to redeem us. That's where our value comes from, so that we can be the eternal inheritance, the trophy of grace for the Son forever. Well, that's the Son's work. I hope you want to praise the Lord Jesus. We have lots of opportunities to praise him every day, and also next week, we're going to praise him for his resurrection. Don't miss that. As we do that together, we can praise the Son because of his provision for us for salvation. Secondly, we should praise God for the Holy Spirit's protection. That's what's found in verses 13 and 14. I'm going to read them to us. In him, this is Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. In him, you also have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, those of you who did, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. The Holy Spirit, we praise him because he is the one that protects us. And this verse tells us, first, that the Spirit sealed us. He is our guard or guardian. The Spirit sealed us. What does this mean to be sealed with the Spirit? Well, it happened when we believed. It says here in this verse that when you believed in him, that's what it says. In him you also heard the word of truth, the gospel of salvation, and believed in him, and then we were sealed. When we believed in Jesus, we were sealed with the Spirit. It happened at the moment we trusted in Jesus. The Holy Spirit sealed us. His seal came upon us. And the meaning is twofold. A seal has the mark, it's a mark of identification. Okay? We're identified as belonging to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. He identifies us as belonging to God. That's what a seal is. You see a seal of something, it's more like a brand, you know. Watch an old Western, see them brand. We are branded. We are branded as belonging to God. But then also, we're protected. The second idea of it is security. You see it placed on goods, a seal. You get a letter, it's sealed. It's protection. That's the idea of it. So the Holy Spirit identifies and guards us. He secures us. And this is for all people who believe, Jews and Gentiles alike, sealed, showing their equality. And the reason I say that, there's the us-you kind of thing happening here in Ephesians 1. I don't know if you picked up on it. Paul talks about us, Jewish believers, you, Gentile believers. And so he says here, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance. It's the way I want you to think of the seal is, remember in 1982, some of you weren't born yet, but in 19, you may have heard that there was the Tylenol murders where someone had gotten in and gotten those capsules and filled them with cyanide. 7 people in the Chicago area died, and it was horrific, and that led to security on medicines, over-the-counter medicines. They would be sealed. That's the idea. Ever since then, now every bottle is sealed. Now, I recognize that that seal can be broken, right? It's secured, but it can be broken. Otherwise, we'd never be able to buy anything and open it. But it is secured until its day of redemption, until it's purchased and opened, right? And if you see one that's been broken, don't buy that, okay? That's not the one you want to use. So that's what happened because of the Tylenol murders. All over-the-counter medicines were secured, sealed. And now what this is saying is when we trusted in Jesus, the Holy Spirit put his seal on us and secured us until the day of redemption when we enter into the presence of God. There's nothing that can be done. No one can break that seal unless you are stronger than the Holy Spirit. We are safe and secure until we stand in the presence of God. How cool is that? I think, well, maybe I can break the seal. I'll get out of here. No. We are sealed securely. It also goes on here in verse 14 to say, the Spirit is our down payment. He is the guarantor of our salvation. It says, who is the guarantee of our salvation? It says, we were sealed with the promised Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. The word that's used there is that he is the earnest. He is the down payment. You remember buying a house? Anyone ever here buy a house? I remember buying my first house. We put $100 down for the contract to make an offer. And they accepted it. I thought, this is cool. Then I found out that's not the earnest money. We had to put down about 25% of the purchase price of the house, or maybe 20%, to say that we're not backing out of this deal. And if we did, guess what would happen to that earnest? We'd lose it. That was the earnest money. That's what the Holy Spirit is for us. He's the earnest. He's the down payment. He is the one that God has put into us to promise us, to assure us that one day we will stand in his presence and we're safe and secure until then. How cool. How great is that? And this is really important because so many of us live in fear. I have a friend that lives in fear. Every time he sins, he's saying, you know what? I don't think I'm going to make it. I think I'm going to lose my salvation. I just don't think I'm going to make it. We struggle with sin in this life, do we not? I do. And yet I know this, that God's grace is greater than all my sin. And it would take a force more powerful than the Holy Spirit to break his seal and throw his earnest away. Not going to happen. We are safe and secure. That doesn't mean we say we're going to sin that grace might abound. Not what that means. But it means I am secure in knowing that God has forgiven every one of my sins, past, present, and future. And one day I will stand pure and blameless. My reality will match my position when I stand before him at the day of redemption. Well, let's do this. Let's have some takeaways. What are we going to do? I mean, obviously we're called to, this is what the pastor is saying, we are called to praise the triune God because the Father planned our salvation, the Son provided it, and the Spirit secures it. That's why we are to praise God. I think we ought to be praising God. So here's a takeaway. Consider where our individual lives would be right now had we not been redeemed from the slave block of sin. Where would you be today if you had not trusted Jesus? I'll tell you where I would be if I had not trusted Jesus. I was determined to be the most caustic, aggressive trial lawyer that I could be. I wanted to make $1 million being the most aggressive trial lawyer possibly. That's what I wanted in my life. And then I met Jesus. And he changed me. He transformed me. And so every time I think I am not growing enough, I am not mature enough, I am not obedient enough, all I can think of, yeah, but God has worked in my life because I am not the person I was once. He is. I think it's always important to go back and see where would we be had we not come to know Jesus, had he not redeemed us from the slave block of sin. So consider that. Think about it. Secondly, identify one specific way where the Lord Jesus transformed you when you came to know him. I would say the one way I was transformed is I thought, I don't care how it is, but I'm going to serve him some way. I am not going to live for the law. I'm going to live for God. And I determined I was going to serve him. That changed my life. Consider how he has changed you, one specific way. And name one specific way that the Holy Spirit has marked your individual life that identifies you as belonging to him. How has the Holy Spirit worked in your life so you say, I know I belong to him. I know I belong to him. I'm still a New Yorker, but I am not that aggressive person that I thought I was. That's the Holy Spirit. That's not me. That's the Holy Spirit's transformation of me, marking me. So that's what I would say we should do as a takeaway of knowing what the Father planned, the Son provided, and the Holy Spirit protects. Now, I really kind of wondered, how am I going to pull this whole thing together? What am I going to do? And I keep coming back to a poem that's kind of corny. I remember reading it the first year I came to know the Lord, and it made me cry. And I think it's just because I'm a mush. But I still think I just keep coming back to it, so I want to read it to you. I don't know, I think a song was made of it. It was called the touch of the master's hand. Have you heard of it? How many have never heard of it? Good. Okay. 'Twas battered and scarred, and the auctioneer thought it scarcely worth his while to waste much time on the old violin, but held it up with a smile. "What am I bidding, good folks?" he cried. "Who'll start the bidding for me? A dollar, then two, only two, $2. Who'll make it three? $3 once, $3 twice, going for three, but no." From the room, far back, a gray-haired man came forward and picked up the bow. Then, wiping the dust from the old violin and tightening the loose strings, he played a melody pure and sweet as a caroling angel sings. The music ceased, and the auctioneer, with a voice that was quiet and low, said, "What am I bid for the old violin?" And he held it up with the bow. $1,000? And who'll make it two? 2,000. Who'll make it three? 3,000 once, 3,000 twice, and going and gone, said he. The people cheered, but some of them cried, "We don't quite understand what changed its worth." Swift came the reply, "The touch of the master's hand." And many a man with life out of tune and battered and scarred with sin is auctioned cheap to the thoughtless crowd, much like the old violin. A mess of pottage, a glass of wine, a game, and he travels on. He's going once and going twice. He's going and almost gone. But the master comes, and the foolish crowd never can quite understand the worth of a soul and the change that's wrought by the touch of the master's hand. We give him praise forever as trophies of his grace. Let's pray. Father God, we can't even begin to express our gratitude to you for what you have done for us. We are just overwhelmed that you redeemed us from the slave block of sin. You planned it, the Son provided it, your Spirit secures it. Oh God, we just give you praise, and we want to praise you forever because of the touch of our Master on our lives. In the name of Jesus the Messiah.
Well, thank you, Dr. Rydelnik. So helpful, such practical truth from God's word. So thankful for that today. Well, listen, I want to invite you to come back next Sunday morning for Easter. And I also want to invite you to invite someone, who's a friend or a family member or someone in your circle of influence who needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this is a great time to invite someone. Easter is such a great time to invite someone to church, and they are going to hear the gospel next Sunday. And so come back next Sunday morning, right here online at 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock Central Time. And if you're ready and you live in the Chicagoland area, we'd love to see you in person at one of our campuses to celebrate Easter together. You are loved.